Today's video is brought to you by Card Kingdom. Head on over to cardkingdom.com to pre-order your Zendikar Rising cards today. Hey friends, I'm back with another gameplay video for you. $80 Yuriko the Tiger Shadow Ninja Tribal. Before we jump into the game though, let's quickly go over the deck we're playing. Yuriko's combat trigger is both a card draw engine and finisher wrapped in one, drawing you cards whenever a ninja you control deals combat damage and making your opponents lose life equal to the card's converted mana cost. But what takes her to the next level is her Commander Ninjutsu ability, letting you sneak her into play by bouncing an unblocked attacker for just 2 mana without ever needing to pay the extra mana for commander attacks. So she can keep getting removed only to be ninjutsu'd back onto the battlefield for 2 mana each time. Being super mana efficient card draw and a finisher wrapped in one, and incredibly resilient to removal makes Yuriko a high powered commander that is a serious contender even at the lowest budgets. Our Yuriko list is pretty standard. The game plan is to cast cheap evasive creatures like Ornithopter, Changeling Outcast, Fairy Seer, and Spectral Sailor, then attack with them so we can ninjutsu in our ninjas like Yuriko, Mistblade Shinobi, and Ingenious Infiltrator to make the most out of Yuriko's powerful combat trigger, or turn all our creatures into ninjas with Arcane Adaptation to get maximum value out of Yuriko. To make Yuriko's combat trigger even deadlier, we're going to run cards with very high converted mana costs so our opponents will lose tons of life whenever we reveal them with Yuriko. We'll use cards that we can cast for way lower than their converted mana cost, like Snuff Out and Treasure Cruise, split cards that have a total converted mana cost equal to both sides of them, like Discovery / Dispersal, and of course Draco, which we'll never cast but is still worth running since we can drain our opponents for a whopping 16 life when we flip it with Yuriko. To make sure we're flipping the most expensive cards with Yuriko, we'll also be running some top deck manipulation cards like Brainstorm and Mystic Sanctuary. And also for the ultimate fun and game ending cards, we've got a bunch of extra turn spells like Temporal Mastery and Temporal Trespass, which can easily close out the game if we have multiple ninjas on the battlefield, because we can attack with them multiple times and trigger Yuriko multiple times and just destroy our opponents. And that's the deck. This is a straightforward aggro tempo deck that draws tons of cards, kills our opponents without even trying, and is really hard to shut down. Even with a budget of just $80, it's still a deck to be feared. So now with the deck intro out of the way, let's hop into the game. Our first opponent is Knusp, who I will call K, running Derevi Imperial Tactician. Derevi is an incredibly powerful commander. Like Yuriko, Derevi can use its activated ability to avoid paying the command tax by putting it directly onto the battlefield for 4 mana instead. Her tap and untap trigger is powerful on its own, but is very oppressive when paired with stacks cards like Stasis, allowing Derevi to continue playing while everyone else is locked down. Our next opponent is Tuck Tuck Jones, who I will call Tuck, playing Marchesa the Black Rose. Marchesa is another powerful commander that leads a combat-focused sacrifice deck, attacking with creatures to put +1/+1 counters on them and then sacrifice them for value, returning them to the battlefield after with Marchesa's ability. Marchesa decks will put us on the clock and are resilient to removal, but I think our Yuriko deck can outrace them. Our final opponent is SD Nation, who I will call S, playing Grimgrin Corpseborn. Grimgrin is usually the leader of a sacrifice-focused zombie deck, providing an efficient sac outlet in the command zone. Zombie decks are usually kinda slow and plodding, but late game they can overwhelm with a horde of tokens or infinite combos, so the plan is to outrace them before they take over. Of the three opponents, I'm most afraid of K's Derevi and Tuck's Marchesa. Both decks have powerful commanders, and while I think Yuriko is the fastest deck at the table, if they manage to establish a strong board quickly, then they could lock us out of the game. Grimgrin I expect to be a big threat, but only later on in the game. After using our free mulligan, I keep a solid hand that can set up a turn 2 Yuriko along with backup protection. We also win the die roll and go first, a huge benefit since our deck is so reliant on tempo. I start with an island and cast Mausoleum Wanderer. All our opponents play their first lands and pass. Turn 2, I swing with the Wanderer and ninjutsu Yuriko, flipping a Spell Pierce. This is definitely not ideal since our opponents only lose 1 life, and tells our opponents that we have counter magic in hand, but hey, value is value. Then I discard down to hand size, discarding Dig Through Time. This was absolutely a punt because I could have used Brainstorm to put it on top of our library and make our opponents lose 8 life with Eureka. In my defense, I made this deck 20 minutes before stream started, and this is my first game playing with Eureka while interacting with chat, so I'm learning the deck as I go. Kay plays a Sungrass Prairie and casts Soulcatcher's Aerie, revealing that they aren't the scary stacks type of Derevi that I was fearing, but rather Bird Tribal. This tribe is rather weak, so I guess they chose the almighty Derevi to help strengthen it. I mentally assigned Derevi as less of a threat for now, making Tuck enemy number 1. Tuck plays a Bloodstained Mire. S plays a Ghost Quarter and passes. On my turn, I attack with Eureka, flipping Notion Thief. Again, it's not ideal that our opponents know about it, but at least 4CMC is a decent chunk of life loss. Then I play an island and cast Siren Storm Tamer, leaving up blue mana to protect Eureka. K plays a Seaside Haven and casts Derevi, tapping our untapped island. I should have tapped the island in response to cast Brainstorm, but again, I'm bad and learning. Tuck plays a Forge of Heroes and casts Rhystic Study, which gets countered by a Swan Song by S. S plays Urborg, Tomb of Yawgmoth, and casts Cemetery Reaper, confirming that they are indeed zombie tribal. On our turn, I decide to clear a path for Eureka by killing the Derevi with Price of Fame, keeping an Ingenious Infiltrator on top of her library. Then I attack an Injutsu in Skull Snatcher, flipping Ingenious Infiltrator and Windcaller Aven and making our opponents lose 10 life in the process. Unfortunately, we didn't hit a land, so our shields are now fully down. I then discard down to hand size, discarding Siren Storm Tamer and Mausoleum Wanderer. Kay also can't find a fourth land and casts Empyrean Eagle. Tuck hits me with the bird, then plays a Polluted Delta and casts Blasphemous Act, clearing the board of all creatures. S plays Cabal Coffers and casts Nivineral's Disc, which makes me reluctant to recast creatures into another board wipe. On my turn, I cast Brainstorm looking for a land but sadly don't find any, which feels especially bad since we have no way to shuffle our deck, so we're just gonna redraw those cards. Since we've got nothing going on, I put Devastation Tide on top of our library, then cast Slither Blade. K casts Cultivate, ramping a Plains and playing an island. Tuck plays a Swamp and casts Marchesa. S plays a Swamp and casts Undead Warchief, starting to build the Zombie Horde. On our turn, I draw Devastation Tide and Miracle It, resetting the board. I figure if I'm behind, I might as well slow down our opponents as well. Then I recast Slither Blade. K casts Derevi and recasts Soulcatcher's Aerie. Tuck plays Diamond Valley and casts Olivia Mobilized for War. S recasts Nivineral's Disc. I attack with Slither Blade and Ninjutsu in Eureka. Tuck responds by cracking Polluted Delta for a Steam Vents untapped and casts Chaos Warp on Eureka, which I counter with Spell Pierce. Eureka then flips an island and I play it. I decide not to recast Slither Blade, assuming S will wipe the board with Disc on their turn, and discard Smoke Shroud, which is actually really good because then it can come back for free later on. K casts Azor's Gateway and loots with it, attacks us with Derevi and untaps the gateway, then loots again, a neat synergy with their commander. Tuck plays Marchesa, discarding Vandalblast with Olivia to give Marchesa a +1/+1 counter and haste, then swings both creatures at me. Tuck is getting very threatening now, having a scary board that is now resilient to removal. S plays a Swamp and casts Undead Warchief and Grimgrin. On our turn, I cast Ponder, finding nothing good, so I shuffle. I then attack Tuck with Eureka, flipping a Sol Ring. I cast Sol Ring, and after some debate, I decide not to cast anything else, keeping my mana up for either Counterspell or Notion Thief. K casts Magus of the Moat, preventing non-flying creatures from attacking, then hits me with Derevi, untapping their plane. Tuck then sacrifices Olivia to Diamond Valley, gaining life and returning Olivia to the battlefield at the end step. Tuck plays Witch's Cottage and casts Necropolis Regent. And not thrilled at the idea of taking an extra 7 damage this turn, I counter it. Then they hit me with Olivia. S plays an island, casts Liliana's Reaver only to unceremoniously sacrifice it to Sidisi, Undead Vizier's exploit, to tutor for a card. On our turn, I get around the moat by cycling Windcaller Aven to give Yuriko flying and hit Tuck, flipping an island. We're good on lands now, but our Yuriko flips have been terrible and our life total is getting chunked down, putting us in a rough spot. I then cast Jace's Phantasm and make the mistake of casting Slitherblade, which can't attack right now due to the moat. Kay loots with Azor's Gateway, plays a Terramorphic Expanse, and hits S with Derevi, untapping the Gateway and looting with it again. At this point, I decide to pull the trigger on Notion Thief, flashing it in and yoinking the card draw for myself. Kay is unhappy with this and decides to wrath the board with Supreme Verdict. Tuck responds by sacrificing Olivia again to Diamond Valley, and when both Olivia and Marchesa return to the battlefield, S pops Nivinril's disc, finally killing them for good. Tuck plays Field of the Dead, making a zombie token, then casts Kindred Discovery, naming vampires, apparently being a vampire tribal deck all along. S drops a bomb on the table with Consecrated Sphinx, and with the rest of the table low on hand sizes, I get afraid that it'll stick around and draw a crazy amount of cards. Luckily, I draw the answer with Murderer's Cut and immediately cast it to kill the Sphinx. Then I cast Ingenious Infiltrator, attaching Smoke Shroud to it from the graveyard. Kay plays a Swamp and casts a fused Beck and Call, creating 4 bird tokens and drawing 4 cards. Tuck plays Rakish Air, drawing a card, then plays Opal Palace, creating a zombie token. Then Tuck plays Ixava, Rakdos Blood Witch, unleashed, and hits S with a zombie and Ixava. On S's turn, they cast Kindred Dominance to wipe the board of creatures, then cast Sword of Light and Shadow. On our turn, I empty my remaining hand, casting Throatseeker and attach Smoke Shroud to it, cast Trident Shorestalker, and then play a Swamp and cast Arcane Adaptation to make all my creatures ninjas. We'll be in a terrible spot if we eat yet another board wipe, but if we survive another turn cycle, we always have a chance to turn this game around with Yuriko. Kay activates Derevi to put her back on the battlefield, untapping their Terramorphic Expanse, then casts Lieutenant Kirtar. Tuck recasts Marchesa and activates Forge of Heroes to give her 3+1+1 counters. S plays a Swamp, casts Skinredder, killing Throatseeker, then casts Corpse Harvester. Low on options, I do the typical Yuriko thing and attack with Trident to Ninjutsu Yuriko in, flipping an Ornithopter. Land flooded and flipping blanks, I really can't catch a break. I recast a Trident and cast Ornithopter. Even running on fumes though, there's always a chance that I flip something amazing and kill all my opponents, so I'm not out of it yet. Kay casts Vanquisher's Banner and hits Tuck with Derevi and Kirtar, then casts Commander Isha and draws a card. Tuck casts Captivating Vampire and plays Rogue's Passage, activating it to give Marchesa unblockable and hits me with her, taking me down to just 13 life. S equips this sword to Skinrender and hits Kay, getting back and recasting Consecrated Sphinx. Big trouble for the table. Then they activate Corpse Harvester, sacrificing the Skinrender to get a Swamp and Grey Merchant of Asphodel. If S doesn't die soon, chances are we're all dead to that merchant. Then S casts Shepherd of Rot. Thankfully, we draw into one of the best cards for the situation, Heart the Water Veil, an extra turn spell. I hit Tuck with Yuriko and Trident, unfortunately continuing to whiff on our flips with a Dimir Signet and an island, but at least the land lets us cast Part the Water Veil with Awaken, making a sweet 6/6 basic land elemental ninja and taking an extra turn. We top deck poorly again, so it's all on our next swing to see if we can win this. I swing the island and Yuriko at Tuck and the Trident at S. Surprisingly, Tuck doesn't block the island, and I get 3 Yuriko triggers. It's now the moment of truth. The first trigger resolved. Ashiok, Dream Render, 3 life loss. The second trigger resolves. Witch's Cottage, 0 life loss. And the final trigger resolves. Azur Smoke Shaper, 4 life loss. All of our opponents are still alive at this point, so we're most assuredly dead at this turn cycle unless somebody wipes the board. I play out my hand anyway, just in case I randomly survive this turn. Kate plays Icon of Ancestry, naming birds and Marshall's Anthem. Then they attack with everything, but end up punting by dividing their attack to only hit S with two creatures instead of all three, leaving them at two life when they could have just been dead. Tuck casts Patron of the Vein, drawing a card, killing Azra's Smokeshaper and pumping their team, then hits me with Captivating Vampire, drawing another card. Finally, it's S's turn, and with 15 cards in hand thanks to Consecrated Sphinx, and all the mana in the world thanks to Cabal Coffers and Urborg Tomb of Yawgmoth, victory is all but assured. They cast Cryptghast, Cage Sun, Reaper from the Abyss, and finally Grey Merchant of Asphodel, draining the rest of the table and winning the game. This game was a long one, but it ended up feeling like an aggressive slugfest all throughout. My opponents were all running unique twists to tribal decks that were fun and interesting to play against. As for my deck, I'm very impressed with how it performed, despite the budget restriction and my poor Yuriko flips. I think I may have even won the game if I played better. Overall, I'm happy with the budget list, but there are some changes I'd like to make, such as replacing Night Veil Sprite, Throat Seeker, and Cunning Evasion, which I felt all underperformed. If I was keeping the same budget, I'd replace them for Augury Owl, Sage Owl, and Wingcrafter, giving the deck better top deck manipulation and evasion. And that wraps up our budget Yuriko gameplay. I stream these games on YouTube every Wednesday at 5:30 p.m. Eastern, and I'd love to have you join me live or even play against me. So until next week, friends, see ya! Thanks for watching the video. If you liked it, help us out by clicking the like button down below. And to keep up with the latest and greatest, make sure to click the subscribe button. And if you want to watch similar videos, click on the links appearing on screen right now.